We use an example of activities of the Soros Centers for Contemporary Art Network, and I will address dependency theories that reflect a theoretical bimodal world system where the core and its art expresses universal normative values, whereas peripheral art represents particular. I will base my argument on the concept of symbolic compensation and argue that the institutionalized cultural capital used to balance the deficit of economic capital in the semi-periphery. The desire of Eastern European countries to cut ties with the communist past and to be reconnected with the Western art world and art history. This desire was fueled by neoliberal ideology dominating at the time and its policy model that switches control of capital factors from the public sector to the private one. In my paper, I'm making some generalization to present phenomena that all of the countries in the region have been experiencing. Thus, I'm also describing certain common tendencies within the SCCA network, strategies, but not particularities of local branches. In years 1987-88, the process of establishing political and economic independence and market economy started with radical reforms in various countries of the Eastern Bloc. It led to liberalization and democratization of economic and social spheres in aim to develop and preserve states and nations as a part of democratic Europe. The transformation from a centrally planned to a market economy caused a serious economic decline and structural crisis that in the cultural field led to a drastic underfinance and eventually to the downfall of the model of then current support system for art and artists. Furthermore, the existing art infrastructure was centrally controlled, hence it required demobilization of art infrastructure and development of bottom-up structures instead. It was one of the reasons the international non-governmental organization, the Soros Centers for the Contemporary Art Network, was established in 1992. And several of its branches were opened in the same year. Within the next few years, the SCCA opened a chain of offices in 18 Eastern European countries. Until 1999, the network functioned as an operating program of the Open Society Foundation, which was initiated by Susie Messoy, an Australian-born Hungarian curator and artist. The network introduced a new style of art management based on a model used by multinational corporations in order to emulate, if not reconstruct, a Western-like institutional and art market structures in Eastern Europe. The aim of the network was to synchronize art from former East and West and establish new art canons in order to rewrite history of art and to reposition Eastern European art as the indispensable part of the global art history. The network goals and procedures were meticulously described in the Soros Foundation, Soros Centers for Contemporary Arts Network's Procedures Manual, called also the Bible. That in fact was an undercover strategy of normalization through bureaucratization and the practices of exclusion and marginalization of group of artists, as well as all current art productions that didn't fit to the SCCA's description of contemporary art. Due to its hard character and effectiveness, this model of art management gained a moniker of coercive philanthropy, which originally was developed by Ford's Foundation. This system is reckoned as the most effective and influential, and as a consequence, it has been applied by many art foundations worldwide, among them the SCCAs. It gave the network dominant position in the region in mid-90s and power to establish a new elite of curators and artists. The SCCA's main goals were one, to document local contemporary art scene, to support young artists, to organize an annual exhibition with an open call for artists and curators, to provide financial support for young artists and young curators, to provide information for foreign curators, artist galleries, critics, and art historians, as well as to nominate artists for international art events like Biennales, Manifesta, etc. The Each ECCA office faced the need of supporting artist production that should satisfy the twofold conditions. One, reconstruction of the country and its culture, and two, readjustment from the peripheral position to the core. On one hand, the CCA favored non-hierarchical relations between the former East and West that were described by terms like building bridges. For that reason, the CCA provided a strategic intention and extensive financial support for Eastern art institutions and local initiatives in order to guarantee them a real partnership with Western art institutions. A partnership that was based not only on cultural or artistic exchange, but also on the wealth equality. On the other hand, the CCA is labeled its goals as synchronization of Europe and used language dominated by the hierarchical ideology typical for transformation period with terms like backwardness of the East and catching up with the West. The CCA's ideas of repositioning the Eastern European art were fueled by the fundamental assumption that there is one hierarchic world. Those assumptions were based on the following theoretical framework. One, classical economic theories that include Emmanuel Wallerstein's world system theory, according to which world is dominated by developed capitalist countries of the core and peripheries or attempting to improve their relative position by using the binary code of various forms of capital. The core takes a dominant position in economics and politics, and periphery is represented by cultural and social capital. And two, the second theory, a theory of symbolic compensation by Polish sociologist Tomasz Zarycki. His approach was based on Pierre Bourdieu's idea of symbolic forms of capital and Lyotardian knowledge-power nexus. Zarycki proposed a thesis that, I quote, in case of Eastern Europe culture, capital constitutes its key resources supposed to compensate for the peripheral status of the country and its deficit of economic capital in relation to the central, coupled with parallel weakness of political capital resources, end of quote. Zarycki also argues that, I quote, the peripheries very often use the strategy of compensation for their weaknesses to offset their dependence on the center, end of quote. Zarycki's thesis seems to be well fitted with the CCA provided its ideologies of serving the center, which were strongly rooted in the system of CCA's policy. For instance, with a view to modernizing the periphery. The CCA introduced a modernizing programs on different levels. It started with a structural modernization of art institution from model of Soviet office culture in Poland branded as the tea culture. And here there's examples like, please answer your phone while you're at the office. To highly professionalized so-called American office culture. The work is organized by clear standardized procedures to maximize efficiency. The CCA provided help for artists in transition period from state-organized, centralized art world to art market, in which one of the lessons was acquisition of the market economy rules as part of the Western artistic idiom. For example, the CCA organized courses on how to apply for a grant or a scholarship, or how to prepare a CV or portfolio, and taught basic public relation rules. Moreover, the CCA activities were rooted in transformation ideology constructed on modernist dream of tabula rasa that is based on the old founding myth of a new beginning. Hasso Krull, Estonian theoretician of culture, called it the culture of interruption, meaning nihilistic and anarchistic art strategies, with a tendency to actively deny all that is related to the recent past. This suggests a kind of point zero at which the former traditions and any influences should be immediately abandoned, not only by artists, but also by art institutions, which in turn should transform itself through the act of radical revolution into modern capitalist organization. The CCA adopted this paradigm of modernization of artistic techniques literary by focusing on new technologies and new media art, which was identified as disruptions of traditions and symbol of international art, far from the pressure from national art schools. However, as Eha Komisarov, Estonian art critic and curator, she noted, I quote, "The history of new media in Estonia, but also in Eastern Europe, is the history of invasion and adaptation, in which the context of local needs is secondary. The adaptation of art to new reality is very much alike the socialization of average citizens in transition societies which underwent shock therapies. Very often, those processes proved unviable. The CCA supported those who adapted to new conditions, mostly young artists and so-called young art, whereas artists from older generations were excluded unless they modernized their art." And I have some visuals also. That's the visuals from the art are a bit like randomly chosen, but they are from the Hungarian Soros Center, which was the headquarters of the network and as such supposed to set an example to the other centers. Therefore, the network faced accusation of promoting art uniformity. Of promoting art uniformity that was mainly oriented on satisfying the requirements of Western professionals who expected artistic product of given qualities. Universal artistic language and Eastern artistic specificity. Consequently, the CCA played an important role in implying the construction of a system of representations that created the phantasmatical Eastern essence of local art. In fact, the global art market expected folklorist art produced in new media, the representation of former East style that reflected Eastern nature and identity and appeared to be timeless entities as archaic, irrational, white, naive. Moreover, SCCA, mainly through its onward exhibitions, was supposed to introduce multiculturalism to the local art discourse with strategy of cultural difference on the background of the idea of primacy of Western cultural forms as universal. Those essentialized identities conserved cultural relationships and cultural capital as a significant factor identity in the rebirth of the regionalism in postmodern nation birth. Reprising the famous Ekaterina Degut sentence, I quote, "Being contemporary artists from the former East meant to represent Western culture in home country, whereas in the West, an Eastern European artist had inevitably to represent the East." This appearance of transnationally emancipated local art on the international scene from entirely different, sometimes even incomparable cultures were branded as similar new art and most famously as Soros realism. This term, coined by Miško Suvaković, Serbian artist and art theoretician, doesn't regard realism in the sense of return to the realism. Suvaković ironically referred to renewed political funding of art that censors not by forbidding, but by financing. The ontology of the Soros realist artwork attains a recognizable morphology. New media, transnational, plus local regional themes, that results in presentation of erased traces of culture. However, this formula of soft and subtle uniformization and standardization of similar new art wasn't probably planned in advance. Rather, it was rooted in a belief in the binary code that theorized the periphery with slogans calling for a total subordination to the art of the center and to the interest of Western art world. Thus, the validation of Eastern European contemporary art came via West. And let's have some examples from Hungary. This rule was accompanied by global art market needs. After the recession in early 80s, the world economy was rapidly growing and therefore encouraging the art market expansion, as well as need of new supplies and resources. That, for its part, evoked an interest in art from the margins, as well as in general, turn in humanities toward dependency theories and thus issues of peripheries. To satisfy this need, the brand New Art from the former East, or Brand East, was created. There are more examples from Budapest. And this is, I have a few examples from Ukraine, from the rap group that worked with Polish and Ukrainian artist curator and also the director of one of the Soros centers in Kiev, Jerzy Onuch, and they together prepared this example of brand Eastern Europe art, and this are there's a series of these works. It was identified by Jerzy Yuri Onuch, Polish-Canadian artist and curator, and later described by Boris Groys as a creation of capitalist market, influenced by contemporary trends in art and culture, as well as social interest in such phenomena as identity, sexuality, ethnic minorities, death, ethic, and politics. It well corresponded to the description of the other famous art trademark of the time, the Young British Art. The idea was reproduced in a series of exhibitions entitled New Art from New Europe, Poland, name one, the blockbusters of so-called Soros family shows like After the Wall, Art and Culture in Post-Communist Europe, Stockholm, 1999, or The Second Half of Europe, Paris 2000, or Aspect Positions, 50 Years of Art in Central Europe from Vienna in 1999, as well as on so-called Second International League shows, Manifesta, all organized by the Western institutions to meet expectations of Western audience. Those art shows were constructed in a mode of great exhibitions of the 19th century, where each country presented its achievements that represented its political, its economic, and cultural status that confirmed its first, second, or third world position. In 1990s, the world art market demanded representation of fashionable otherness in an attempt to create an illusion of virtual world without hierarchical geography. Last but not least, Tomasz Zarecki suggests that in the early 90s, to Eastern European elites, the choice of the central option could not have been more context-based and pragmatic. It means largely based on principles of the rational choice and comparing the benefits and advantages connected with central areas whose organization logic is dominant point of reference for the periphery. Thank you.